Thank you all for being here. Thank you to the Saffron Synagogue. Thank you very much to Naomi for having the idea for this event and making it possible. The question of the legality of Jewish presence in Judea and Samaria is central to all discussions of the Israeli-Arab conflict. And unlike pretty much every other geopolitical conflict, the Israeli-Arab conflict is, even in popular discussions, almost invariably framed in legal terms. So when we hear, for example, about the Turco-Cypriot conflict, which is not often, but on the news they'll say Turkish presence in northern Cyprus. But they won't say which is illegal or which is considered illegal. Russia's occupation of Crimea without any legal characterization. And on the other hand, invariably, any discussion of the Israeli presence in Judea and Samaria, the West Bank, is coupled with a legal characterization. Israeli settlements in the West Bank, which are illegal under international law. And as a result, the legal issues are central here. However, in these discussions of the legal issues, it's never said. So when you read the New York Times, when you listen to NPR, Israeli settlements which are against international law. What you don't hear is an explanation of which international law is it against. Which international law is it against? Which, you know, is not a very Jewish way. If you're trying to convince a Jew of a proposition in Jewish law, you have to tell them, where do you find this? Where is this brought down in halacha? So they don't tell us where it's brought down. They don't tell us where it's brought down. And I'm going to sort of skip to the end and then backtrack a little bit. The entire discussion of the legality of Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria is premised on just a few words in a completely obscure provision of a very specialized treaty, words which have never been interpreted or applied to any other country, in one particular treaty, which does not even apply to Israel for various reasons. And the relevant sentence, what do people mean when they say settlements are illegal? First of all, what they really mean is that Israel is required by some principle of international justice to maintain Judea and Samaria as a Jew-free zone indefinitely until the Palestinians agree to take it off their hands and maintain it as a Jew-free zone themselves. But pending that, Israel is obligated to ensure that the areas from which Jordan expelled the Jews in 1949 remain depopulated of Jews indefinitely. And that is a fairly shocking proposition when put in those terms. That's why people want to talk about it as the legality of settlements. Because when it's translated into what it means, that Israel must maintain a Jew-free zone, it doesn't sound as nice. That's why the legal rhetoric is important. That's why it's important to put it in those words. And it's important to say at the outset, the notion that a country, whether it be an occupying power or not, even assuming it's an occupying power, is required by law to keep a certain territory under its control, free of its own citizens, is not that is not something that has ever been asked of any country in the world. It is not something that any country has been asked to do. It is not something that any country has done, and is not something any country has been faulted for failing to do. It's an unprecedented demand. Now, in the case of Israel, the demand is said to arise from Article 49.6 of the Fourth Geneva Convention. I don't know if that helps you a lot. The Fourth Geneva Convention, it's a treaty. Right? So we have to ask whether the treaty applies, what it means. Article 49.6 says the occupying power shall not deport or transfer parts of its own civilian population to the territory that it occupies. That's the whole deal. The entire notion is based on this one sentence. The occupying power, which is alleged to be Israel, shall not deport or transfer parts of its civilian population to the territory that it occupies. And we see something already very interesting. In law, secular law, halakha, usually, when you have a legal concept, it goes by the name of the, you know, the words in the provision giving rise to it. The statutory terms. So it's interesting that the complained of activities aren't called deport. Why do they call them settlements? Because if they were to use the language of the treaty, they would have to call them deportation or transfer centers. It doesn't say the word settlement in that provision I just mentioned. As a matter of fact, it doesn't say settlement anywhere, pretty much. Settlement is not a word from international law. What is a word from international law? Deportation or transfer. But if they called them deportation or transfer centers, it would raise the question, how did this deportation happen? Who deported who where? When did Israel transfer these people? So those are awkward questions. By the way, where does the word settlement come from? It's just a translation of the Hebrew word yeshuv, which means small town, new town, regardless of where it is in relation to the Green Line. So the fact that the international law concept goes by a term borrowed from Hebrew shows this isn't international law. This is a law for one country only. The French, by the way, there's a different term in French. The settlements in French are called, I believe, les colonies israélites, which is even more obnoxious, Israeli colonies, which is even more obnoxious. But again, these are not general terms of international law. These are not general terms of international law. So that's the one provision. No other country, since the adoption of the Geneva Convention, has ever been cited by the international community for violating Article 49.6. Not Turkey with its settlements in northern Cyprus, not Morocco with its settlements in Western Sahara, not Russia with its settlers in Crimea, and the list actually is very long. The understanding that allowing one's own civilians to move into a territory violates this very obscure article of a fairly specific treaty, that idea only emerged in 1968, 1967, when Jews started moving to Judea and Samaria, and has since not been applied in any other context. Basic point, what is international law? What is international law? Well, for something to be law, what is law? Law is a system of general rules that are applied to unknown future situations. Right? A law is a rule. If X, then Y. And you don't know the X. If someone does something, this is what happens. And you don't know who's going to do it. That's a law. And what's international? International is dealing with multiple countries. So if something is not a rule that is generally applied but only applies to one case, it's not law. And if it's only applied to one country, it's not international. So that's a very big challenge for the understanding that these statements that are just about Israel could be a form of international law. Okay, question is, so I mentioned the Fourth Geneva Convention, and it sounds very impressive. It's a Geneva Convention. It has a Roman numeral in front of it. What's that have to do with Israel? So important point, treaties are deals between countries that govern specific situations. They're not the law of God, which deal with everything. They deal with, the Geneva Convention is a treaty about the protection of civilians during wartime. So that raises a lot of questions. What's the war? The relevant provisions deal with the occupation of the territory of another country. Occupation of territory. So before we even consider what does it mean to deport and transfer one's population, What does that look like? The first question is, so it's nice that it says this in the Geneva Convention, but what's the Fourth Geneva Convention have to do with the conflict? That is to say, is there an occupation? Is there an occupation? And to understand whether there's an occupation, the first question is, whose territory is this? Whose territory? Now, you know, even though one cannot, in international law, occupy one's own territory. Right? That's impossible. You can't be self-occupying. Right? You can't be self-occupying. So the question is, it has to be shown first that Israel's not self-occupying, because if you're self-occupying, it's not occupation. So the question is, whose territory, what was the status of this territory in 1967? And this is a very important point. To understand the legal aspects of the title to the territory, one has to go back. So I was on this radio program yesterday with Rashid Khalidi, and he said something which was very wrong. But despite it being very wrong, it is actually something many supporters of Israel believe, something many, very many Zionist people believe. That's not why he was saying it, but it happens to be a misconception shared by Rashid Khalidi and many supporters of Israel. And that misconception is that the borders of the State of Israel, or the legitimacy for the State of Israel, the international basis for the State of Israel, was created through United Nations Resolution 181 in 1947. So it's completely not true. That resolution did nothing to help Israel. It did nothing at all from a legal perspective. And it certainly does not provide the international legal legitimacy for Israel. We'll talk about what it did in a second. So the basis, the story really begins with the League of Nations mandate in 1922. So after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, the League of Nations, which was formed, the predecessor to United Nations, was given the power by the member countries, which included Britain and France and Turkey, to administer a kind of trusteeship system to transform the former Ottoman territories into independent nation states. And pursuant to that, why did the League of Nations have the power to do this? Very important point. Because it said in the treaty creating the League of Nations that the countries were giving them this power. So it was explicit in the treaty creating the League of Nations that they would have the power to oversee this system of mandates. And pursuant to this, they issued a mandate for Palestine. And the mandate for Palestine provided for the creation of a Jewish national home in a territory which includes what we would call now today Israel, the West Bank, Gaza Strip, and this entire other big thing called the Hashemite, which today is the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. The mandate also provided that if it turns out that territory is too big for the creation of a Jewish national home, it could be split down the middle along the Jordan River and a separate regime created on the other side. And Britain immediately did that and created the Transjordan, which then became the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, using the provision of the mandate that it could be split down the middle. So this raises already, so we've already covered a lot of ground. If you ever have debates with your friends on your college campuses, does Jordan have a right to exist? Right, it's a burning issue. Why should Jordan exist? There was never a Jordan until 100 years ago. You know, it has that weird little protrusion into Iraq, known as Winston's Hiccup. So why do they get to have that weird protrusion? What's the legitimacy for this? Where's their international birth certificate, as Rashid Khalidi would put it? So the birth certificate is the League of Nations mandate. The entire existence of Jordan within its borders is due to one sentence in the League of Nations mandate, the part about splitting it. So what's left of the mandate? What's left of the mandate is the area we would today call Israel, Judea, and Samaria, the Golan Heights. And if you were to ask anybody, January 1st, 1948, what are the borders of mandatory Palestine, they would say everything between the river and the sea. Britain administered the mandate between the river and the sea. until they stopped administering it. And the boundaries of Mandatory Palestine, until the creation of Israel, are not at all in dispute. Then the mandate ends, and the State of Israel is created. This is a very important moment. What are the borders of this new state? What are the borders? So it turns out, in international law, there are not many hard and fast rules in international law, and there are actually not that many rules in international law. But for this, there is actually a very established rule, because it's a very important and high-stakes situation. When a new country is created, which happens, you know, not infrequently, what are the borders of the new country? And why is it important to have a clear international law rule for this? Because otherwise, every time there's a new country created, every single inch of its border would be up for dispute based on, you know, the variety of considerations that could go into national borders. History, topography, ethnic separations. And that would be a recipe for constant war. Instead, there's a very clear rule. The rule is called the Iuti Pater Dedis principle. And it says when a new country is created, you don't have to spell that, when a new country, but this is an absolutely hard and fast rule. You can try it at home. Seriously, you go home, pick your favorite new country, see if this works. The Iuti Pater Dedis principle says that when a new country is created, either through the breakup of a larger country, the end of an imperial system, the dissolution of a federation, the borders of the new country are the borders of the last top-level administrative unit in that territory. So, for example, Yugoslav Federation breaks up, the borders of each of the new countries are the constituent federal borders of the constituent federal units. So, for example, let's say California decides to secede because of the election of President Trump to become Republica Pacifica. So, you know, what are the borders of California? It would be the borders of the US state of California. Aye, but there's some people up north, the Shasta County farmers, who don't want to be part of it. Tough luck. And there's like some hipsters in Oregon who kind of consider themselves to be culturally part of California and they would want to be part of it. Tough luck. The borders are the borders of the new country. And we see this happen for every other mandate issued by the League of Nations, and this is a very important point. The mandate for Palestine was not special. It was one of numerous mandates issued by the League of Nations. All of them were met with demands for partition, redivision, or otherwise redrawing the borders because the borders of the mandate territory were supposed to be unfair. So for example, Syria was unhappy about the creation of a separate Lebanon and the inclusion of various Muslim districts like the Bekaa Valley in the previous region of Mount Lebanon, which was a smaller Christian enclave. The Turks were very unhappy about the inclusion of northern Iraq, Mosul, in the borders of the mandate for Mesopotamia. And the Kurds were not happy about it either. The Kurds were promised also, off and on, a state of their own in northern Iraq by the British. They said, it's not fair. Why don't we get a state of our own? Whether it's fair or not, at the moment of the creation of Iraq, within the boundaries of the mandate for Mesopotamia, the borders of Iraq are the borders of the former mandate. And this works every single time. Let me just give you an example of this principle. Take, for example, Crimea, as Vladimir Putin recently did. The international community says, even if Russia occupies this for 20 years, we're going to consider it as part of Ukraine. Is it because most of the people there are Ukrainian? No. Is it because they're like, you know, religiously or culturally or linguistically closer to Ukraine? No. Indeed, the entire territory of Crimea was part of Russia until the 1950s, a part of this part of Russia, when Nikita Khrushchev, as General Secretary of the Central Committee of the Politburo redrew the map to put Crimea in Ukraine. And it didn't really matter then, because they were all being governed from the Kremlin anyway. However, when the Soviet Union collapses, Ukraine becomes an independent country. What are the borders of Ukraine? The borders of the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic, even if it's not fair, even if it's just based on a decision of Nikita Khrushchev. And certainly this is the case with mandatory territories. Now, there are, so everyone agrees in all other situations that when you have a mandate territory, the borders of the new country created therein, be it Lebanon, be it Syria, be it Iraq, are the borders of the previous mandate territory. Because if you do not accept the validity of mandatory borders, you call into question all of the borders of the Middle East and much of Africa. Now, there are three, I want to name, there are indeed three prominent international political figures who have doubted the validity of mandatory borders. So the first, and I should just mention them, just so I don't make it seem like everybody agrees. So Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein did not accept the mandatory borders of Iraq. Right, when he invaded Kuwait, he wasn't just invading Kuwait stam, just saying like, I want Kuwait. He was saying, why should our southern border be determined by this arbitrary mandatory thing when we have historic claims to the contrary? Nobody in the international community backed that play. The Assad family, Bashir, his father Hafez. So we do not accept the existence of Lebanon as a separate country, because that was created by the French under the mandate. Much of Lebanon used to be part of Syria. We don't accept that. And they invaded and occupied it in the 80s. International community did not accept that. So we have Hussein, Assad, and Barack Obama and John Kerry, who say that Israel, the borders of Israel, shouldn't be the borders of the mandate. Other than that, the difference is the international community does back that play to a significant extent. But that's not international law, as we have seen from Syria and Iraq and other cases. So when Israel retook the territory occupied by Jordan, so what are the borders of Israel at the moment of its creation? The way this international law rule works, it's the birthday principle. At the moment of creation, borders of Israel would be from the river to the sea. Now, it's true that Jordan invades, and Egypt invades, and Iraq invades, and they occupy much of this territory. But the fact that the territory is occupied for 19 years does not change Israel's claim. I don't think anyone in the international community would say, if Putin hangs out for another 15 years in Crimea, it's his. And indeed, when Israel retakes this territory in 1967, it is retaking a territory to which it has a claim of sovereignty under the mandate. That's a very important point. What about the General Assembly resolution? General Assembly resolution 181. So it became clear after World War II that when the British would leave and stop administering the mandate, and the Jews would create their own state, that this would be met with violence. There was already a guerrilla war, that the Arabs would attack, the Jews would get massacred. That was the conventional assumption, was the Jews were gonna lose the war. There's actually an amazing document that was declassified recently. It's a CIA cable, US intelligence cable to the State Department, in which they argued that the State Department, the US, should oppose the UN partition plan. They should oppose it, because they said, if there's partition, we don't think the neighboring Arab countries would invade, because how could they not listen to the UN? However, the Arabs already in Palestine will at least engage in a civil war, a guerrilla war, and they will wipe out the Jews. So the State Department hasn't changed so much. That's a prediction that was wrong on every single point. But that was the conventional wisdom. Conventional wisdom was it was going to be very bad for the Jews, and everyone would have to feel bad again. So there was an idea that there should try to be some kind of internationally brokered compromise to prevent further conflict. So let's share the land. Let's split the land again, and then you won't have to fight. The UN General Assembly sent over a whole bunch of experts. They conducted interviews and engaged in various kind of fact-finding, and they said, we have a proposal now. We have a plan. And they proposed this very complicated division of Palestine into multi-sectoral, highly non-contiguous Jewish and Arab states. And they said, this is what we think would be a good idea. Now, what's the legal status of that? So the legal status of that is really nothing. Why? For a number of reasons. First of all, the General Assembly does not have the power to do anything within the international legal system. It has no power to take any kind of binding action. Because why? So why can the League of Nations create mandates, but the General Assembly can't change things? Because of the Charter of the United Nations. The Charter of the United Nations specifically does not give legislative power to the General Assembly, because who would give legislative power to a system based on the majority vote of countries? So General Assembly doesn't have the power. The United Nations probably does not have the power, because Article 80, paragraph 1 of the UN Charter makes clear that the United Nations accepts as valid existing mandatory arrangements and cannot change them. And finally, if you read the resolution, it's quite clear that they weren't saying they were actually changing anything. You know, with the United Nations, the most important thing when they have resolutions, what the verb is, right? Do they condemn? Do they strongly condemn? Do they deplore? Those are the things they can do. The verb the General Assembly used is they say, we recommend. This is what we think would be a good idea. We recommend. And who are they recommending to? Britain, because Britain is the mandatory power, was the only one that could administer changes into the administration of the territory. And Britain, as soon as they saw this resolution, and they looked at the very complicated maps attached to it, they said, we have enough problems already without this kind of very ambitious solution. And so as a matter of historical fact, that partition proposal was never implemented. Whether it was a good idea, whether it was a bad idea, it did not come to pass. And as a result, on May 1st, 1948, it was quite clear that the borders of Palestine remained as they had previously been, and those borders become the borders of the State of Israel. Now, as a result, when Israel takes this territory in 1967, there's really, you can't speak of occupation. So the Geneva Convention applies only when there is a war between two countries that are both members of the Geneva Convention, and then to any, if there's an occupation, until the end of the occupation. So let's consider three possibilities. So an occupation is when the territory of a party to the Geneva Convention is occupied. So if the territory is Israel's, it can't be occupied. If the territory is Israel's, it can't be occupied. But what if the territory is not Israel's, but it's not Jordan's either, it's just kind of nobody's? Well, the Geneva Convention specifies that it applies to occupation of the territory of another country. So if it's Israel's, there's no occupation. If it's nobody's, there's no occupation. But what if you want to say, okay, it might not have been strictly speaking Jordan's, but it's Jordan's enough. Jordan was administering it. Jordan was the de facto power. So maybe it's like de facto Jordanian territory, and that's enough for the provisions of the Geneva Convention to apply. Well, guess what? There's a peace treaty with Jordan since 1994. And the Geneva Convention is not a statement of the conditions that should exist for all time. It's about the rules of war. And they also govern subsequent occupations. And they end with a peace treaty. A peace treaty, the Geneva Conventions are treaties about war, and a peace treaty terminates their application. Thank you. There is no other example you will find in the world of anybody looking to see what the Geneva Conventions say in a conflict between two parties, 20 years after a peace treaty has been signed. There's just no such thing. So if it was Israel's, there's no occupation. And if it was nobody's, there's no occupation. And if it was Jordan's, there's no occupation. So if there's no occupation, the Article 49.6 has absolutely no relevance. And that is the correct position. Now, even if somehow one thinks it is occupied and that Article 49.6 has relevance, the question is, where is the deportation or transfer? Where is the deportation or transfer? The international community wants to read this provision as saying, not that the occupying power cannot engage in kind of mass rounding up of people and moving them into an occupied territory. What's transfer mean? To take people and pick them up and move them. The international community says, but Israel provides water to them. It provides security. The army protects them. First of all, if the Geneva Conventions applies, actually the military is obligated to protect everybody in the occupied territory. But by adopting this kind of understanding, what the international community do is they flip 49.6 on its head. Instead of being a prohibition on taking certain kinds of actions, it becomes an affirmative requirement to prevent Jews from entering the territory at all and to starve them out, to not provide them water, not provide them municipal services, and make their life impossible if they choose to come. Now, that doesn't seem to be what it says, but let's say you want to interpret it that way. It becomes very difficult to interpret it that way, given that it has not been interpreted that way in any other similar situation. Take America, for example. America occupies West Berlin from 1945 until, anybody know? 1990. West Berlin was never made part of the Federal Republic of Germany. It was a separate entity under a tripartite occupation system. Did anyone ever suggest that America has to make sure Americans don't move to West Berlin? Which they did, by the way. Did anyone even suggest that anyone has to think about checking to see if Americans are moving into West Berlin? There's never been such a suggestion. Russia has been extremely criticized by the international community for its occupation of Crimea and for numerous things that it has done in Crimea. So it's not that the world is shy about criticizing Russia. One thing the international community has not said anything about is the 70,000 some Russians who have moved into Crimea just in the past year and a half. And I can go on with examples like this. The most amazing thing when you study the question of settlers elsewhere, which is what I do, is that nobody knows how many there are. So when you look at Vietnamese settlers in Cambodia, estimates range from like 200,000 to 1 million. Turkish settlers in northern Cyprus, estimates vary by hundreds of thousands. Russian settlers in Crimea, no one has any idea. Chinese and Tibet are a possible example. And so why does nobody know? Because nobody cares, because they don't think it matters, because they don't think it's illegal. Because nobody's counting. Nobody's counting. As I like to say, where is Shalom Akshav when you need them? So if it really mattered, if it was a violation of international law, there'd be little drones flying around, like there are in Judea and Samaria. The European Union sends drones to count and to see who is enclosing their merpeset and who is not. Vietnamese settlers in Cambodia, we don't know to within a few hundred thousand, which suggests it wasn't relevant for any legal question. It wasn't relevant. So the question is, what do you do with the fact that much of the international community seems to be of a different mind? And what does one do with the fact that the United Nations recently passed a Security Council resolution saying it's illegal? Now, I think we should all be very careful how we describe this United Nations Security Council resolution. The Security Council resolution did not say settlements are illegal. I read it very carefully. It never says settlements are illegal. It says settlements are illegal if they're done by Israel. Right? Now, if they want to state a general principle of international law, then you say, ah, this is our anti-settlement resolution. Settlements are illegal. They don't say settlements are illegal. They say Israeli settlements are illegal, which does not sound like a legal principle. But as a practical matter, or as a legal matter, the Security Council is not a legislature, and it's not a court. It does not have the authority to make or interpret international law, and the resolution of at least the kind that was adopted a few weeks ago does not have any technical legal weight. Now, that is not to say that it does not have a lot of practical and diplomatic weight. And the purpose of such resolutions is not to have any specific legal consequence, but to crystallize opinion, to act as a rallying cry for various forces, to promote boycotts and various trade measures against Israel. And the best way to resist such a resolution is for the United States to fight the very idea of this resolution. The resolution says settlements are illegal. The resolution says any Jewish presence across the Green Line is, I would say, contaminated, I think is the right word, because the resolution says you can't touch them. You can have no dealings with them. Impure. Put the American embassy in Eastern Jerusalem. That's the answer to that. Put the American embassy in Eastern Jerusalem. There's already a large American diplomatic facility there, a consulate. Because the way to fight it is to show that one does not accept the fundamental premises and to show it in action. And when the American embassy, let's say, is in Eastern Jerusalem, the European ambassadors, they're not going to visit the American embassy. They're going to say to the American ambassador, we're not going to your party. I can't see them having it in them. And it creates a different legal reality. That's one thing. Another thing is to not accept the narrative. The Palestinians can teach us a huge amount. When the PLO was first created, they were universally seen as a terrorist group espousing a fairly extremist and unreasonable position and making highly impractical demands of Israel. However, they stuck to their guns, so to speak, and maintained the same position for decades. And that adherence and belief in one's narrative makes an impression. The Palestinians never said, when they were blowing up planes in the 1970s and everybody thought they were terrorists and nobody thought that Israel should negotiate with them, they never said, the international community is not buying our position, we should just give up and adopt a different position. And I think that's a very powerful lesson we could learn. Many people say, well, you know, what's the use of talking about these things? Because the international community rejects our viewpoint. We have not even begun to explain our viewpoint. We've not begun to insist on our viewpoint. They reject it because we don't demand it. So I think it is not time to get discouraged. In terms of the Security Council resolution, what really matters is what happens on the ground. And the United States, let me put it this way. This resolution, we know, has been planned for many years. There was an article in the Washington Post, I think 2 years ago, in which President Obama asked the State Department to prepare a variety of ultimate actions for him, including these resolutions. So it's been in the works for a long time. And I believe an original part of the conception of how it would work involved an assumption about electoral outcomes that did not come to pass. And as a result, there's really a chance to change the fundamental assumptions. There are many United Nations Security Council resolutions that have demanded many things, which have entirely not come to pass. Nobody remembers them. Nobody mourns them. Nobody insists on them. Take, I believe it's a resolution 1871, but I may be wrong, resolution from about 12 years ago, demanding the disarmament of Hezbollah in southern Lebanon. So what's happened then? First of all, Hezbollah has not been disarmed. Instead, they have gotten tens of thousands of rockets pointed at Israel, and with the help of Iran, have taken over the government of Lebanon, as opposed to being disarmed. Nobody says, well, Lebanon, you can't have this Hezbollah-controlled government because of the UN Security Council resolution. So what matters is what happens, and that's what we need to focus on. Thank you very much. I'll take questions.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.